Simon & Schuster Audio presents 127 Hours Between a Rock and a Hard Place. Written and read by Aron Ralston.
Fraying contrails streak another bluebird sky above the red desert plateau, and I wonder how many sunburnt days these badlands have seen since their creation. It's Saturday morning, April 26th, 2003, and I am mountain biking by myself on a scraped dirt road in the far southeastern corner of Emery County in central eastern Utah. An hour ago, I left my truck at the dirt trailhead parking area for Horseshoe Canyon, the isolated geographic window of Canyonlands National Park that sits 15 air miles northwest of the legendary Maze District, 40 miles southeast of the great Razorback uplift of the San Rafael Swell, 20 miles west of the Green River, and some 40 miles south of I-70, that corridor of commerce and last chances. Next services, 110 miles. With open tablelands to cover for 100 miles between the snow-capped ranges of the Henrys to the southwest, the last range in the U.S. to be named, explored, and mapped, and the LaSalles to the east, a strong wind is blowing hard from the south, the direction I'm heading. Besides slowing my progress to a crawl, I'm in my lowest gear and pumping hard on a flat grade just to move forward. The wind has blown shallow drifts of maroon sand onto the washboarded road. I try to avoid the drifts, but occasionally they blanket the entire road and my bike founders. Three times already I've had to walk through particularly long sandbogs. The going would be much easier if I didn't have this heavy pack on my back. I wouldn't normally carry 25 pounds of supplies and equipment on a bike ride, but I'm journeying out on a 30-mile-long circuit of biking and canyoneering, traversing the bottom of a deep and narrow canyon system, and it will take me most of the day. Besides a gallon of water, stored in an insulated 3-liter Camelback hydration pouch and a 1-liter Nalgene bottle, I have 5 chocolate bars, 2 burritos, and a chocolate muffin in a plastic grocery sack in my pack. I'll be hungry by the time I get back to my truck, for certain, but I have enough for the day. The truly burdensome weight comes from my full stock of rappelling gear. 3 locking carabiners, 2 regular carabiners, a lightweight combination belay and rappel device, 2 tied slings of half-inch webbing, a longer length of half-inch webbing with 10 pre-stitched loops called a daisy chain, my climbing harness, a 60-meter-long and 10.5-millimeter-thick dynamic climbing rope, 25 feet of 1-inch tubular webbing, and my rarely used Leatherman knockoff multi-tool with 2 pocket knife blades and a pair of pliers that I carry in case I need to cut the webbing to build anchors. Also in my backpack are my headlamp, headphones, CD player and several fish CDs, extra AA batteries, digital camera and mini digital video camcorder, and their batteries in protective cloth sacks. It adds up, but I deem it all necessary, even the camera gear. I enjoy photographing the otherworldly colors and shapes presented in the convoluted depths of slot canyons and the prehistoric artwork preserved in their alcoves. This trip will have the added bonus of taking me past 4 archaeological sites in Horseshoe Canyon that are home to hundreds of petroglyphs and pictographs. The U.S. Congress added the isolated canyon to the otherwise contiguous Canyonlands National Park specifically to protect the 5,000-year-old etchings and paintings found along the Barrier Creek watercourse at the bottom of Horseshoe, a silent record of an ancient people's presence. At the Great Gallery, dozens of 8 to 10-foot-high superhumans hover en echelon over groups of indistinct animals, dominating beasts and onlookers alike with their long, dark bodies, broad shoulders, and haunting eyes. The superbly massive apparitions are the oldest and best examples of their design type in the world. Such preeminent specimens that anthropologists have named the heavy and somewhat sinister artistic mode of their creators the Barrier Creek style. Though there is no written record to help us decipher the artist's meaning, a few of the figures appear to be hunters with spears and clubs. Most of them, legless, armless, and horned, seem to float like nightmarish demons. Whatever their intended significance, the mysterious forms are remarkable for their ability to carry a declaration of ego across the millennia and confront the modern observer with the fact that the panels have survived longer and are in better condition than all but the oldest golden artifacts of Western civilization. This provokes the question, What will remain of today's ostensibly advanced societies 5,000 years hence? Probably not our artwork, nor any evidence of our record amounts of leisure time, if for no other reason than most of us fritter away this luxury in front of our television sets. In anticipation of the wet and muddy conditions in the canyon, I'm wearing a pair of beat-up running shoes and thick wool-blend socks. Thus insulated, my feet sweat as they pump on my bike pedals. My legs sweat, too, compressed by the Lycra biking shorts I'm wearing beneath my beige nylon shorts. Even through double-thick padding, my bike seat pummels my rear end. Up top, I have on a favorite fish t-shirt and a blue baseball cap. I left my waterproof jacket back at my truck. The day is going to be warm and dry, just like it was yesterday when I biked the 12-mile loop of the Slick Rock Trail over east of Moab. If it were going to be rainy, a slot canyon would be the last place I'd be headed, jacket or no. Lightweight travel is a pleasure to me, and I figured out how to do more with less so I can go farther in a given amount of time. Yesterday, I had just my small Camelback with a few bike repair items and my cameras, a measly 10-pound load for the 4-hour loop ride. In the evening, pairing out the bike gear, I hiked 5 miles on an out-and-back visit to a natural arch out toward Castle Valley, carrying only 6 pounds total of water and camera equipment. The day before, Thursday, with my friend Brad Ewell from Aspen, I'd climbed and skied Mount Sopris, the 12,995-foot monarch of western Colorado, and had carried a few extra clothes and backcountry avalanche rescue gear, but I still kept my load under 15 pounds. My 5-day road trip will culminate on Sunday night with an unsupported solo attempt to mountain bike the 108-mile White Rim Trail in Canyonlands National Park. If I carried the supplies I'd used over the 3 days it took me the first time I rode that trail in 2000, I'd have a 60-pound pack and a sore back before I went 10 miles. In my planning estimates this time around, I'm hoping to carry 15 pounds and complete the loop in under 24 hours. It will mean following a precision-charted water management plan to capitalize on the scarce refilling opportunities, no sleeping, and only the bare minimum of stopping. My biggest worry isn't that my legs will get tired. I know they will, and I know how to handle it. But rather that my undercarriage will become too sensitive to allow me to ride. As I haven't ridden my bike any extended distance since last summer, my bike saddle tolerance is disconcertingly low. Had I anticipated this trip prior to 2 nights ago, I would have gone out for at least one long ride in the Aspen area beforehand. As it happened, some friends and I called off a mountaineering trip at the last moment on Wednesday. The cancellation freed me for a hodge to the desert, a pilgrimage for warmth, to reacquaint myself with a landscape other than wintry mountains. Usually, I would leave a detailed schedule of my plans with my roommates, but since I left my home in Aspen without knowing what I was going to do, the only word of my destination I gave was Utah. I briefly researched my trip options by consulting my guidebooks as I drove from Mount Sopris to Utah Thursday night. The result has been a capriciously impromptu vacation, one that will even incorporate dropping in on a big campout party near Goblin Valley State Park tonight. It's nearing 10:30 a.m. as I pedal into the shade of a very lonesome juniper and survey my sun-baked surroundings. The rolling scrub desert gradually drops away into a region of painted rock domes, hidden cliffs, weathered and warped bluffs, tilted and tortured canyons, and broken monoliths. This is hoodoo country. This is voodoo country. The red wasteland beyond the end of the roads. Since I arrived after dark last night, I wasn't able to see much of the landscape on my drive into the trailhead. As I scan the middle ground to the east for any sign of my destination canyon, I take out my chocolate muffin from the Moab Grocery's bakery and have to practically choke it down. Both the muffin and my mouth have dried out from the exposure to the arid wind. I wash down the muffin, except for a few crumbs in the wrapper, with several pulls from the Camelback's hydration tube fastened to my shoulder strap. Remounting, I roll down the road in the wind-protected lee of the ridgeline in front of me. But at the top of the next hill, I'm thrust into battle against the gusts once more. After another 20 minutes pistoning my legs along this blast furnace of a road, I see a group of motorbikers passing me on their way to the maze district of Canyonlands. The dust from the motorbikes blows straight into my face, clogging my nose, my ears, my tear ducts, even gluing itself to my teeth. I grimace at the grit pasted on my lips, lick my teeth clean, and press on, thinking about where those bikers would be headed. I visited the maze only once myself for about a half an hour, nearly 10 years ago. When our Cataract Canyon rafting party pulled over in the afternoon to set up camp along the Colorado River at a beach called Spanish Bottom, I hiked 1,000 feet up over the rim rock into a place known as the Doll's House. 50 to 100-foot tall hoodoo rock formations towered above me as I scrambled around the sandstone and granite like a Lilliputian. When I finally turned around to look back at the river, I jerked to a halt and sat on the nearest boulder with a view. It was the first time the features and formative processes of the desert had made me pause and absorb just how small and brave we are, we the human race. Down behind the boats at Spanish Bottom, a furious river churned. Suddenly, I perceived in its auburn flow that it was, even at that exact moment, carving that very canyon from 1,000 square miles of desert tablelands.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.